Guys, have you ever wondered if we all wanted our own publicly registered IP address and that too IP address version 4, what would have happened? Well, we would have run out of IP4 addresses a long time back. So what exactly NAT does is it helps us preserve these IP, publicly registered IP addresses with a mechanism which we'll understand in this video. So in this video, we'll understand the basic of NAT. How exactly it works. We also understand some types of NATs which we use, and then a simplistic architecture overview of how a NATing works. So without further ado, let's get on with our understanding of what is network address translation. Thank you, friends. If you're new to ITkFUNDE channel, we make IT interesting for everyone, be it IT or non-IT. We discuss all the latest tools and technologies, products, productivity hacks, and career tips on this channel. So if you're new and if you like the content, do consider subscribing. So let's start with an example. Suppose there's a startup XYZ which has recently opened its office with three different developers working on a new application. Now, this is a new startup and they have registered for one specific public IP address, because you cannot have public registered IP address for all your developers. So there could be hundreds of developers joining this company working on some application, right? So these publicly available registered IP addresses, IPv4 addresses, are limited, first of all. And secondly, there is no point of giving unique registered IP addresses to all your developers. It will be expensive, and obviously it is not possible as well, because these are limited in numbers. So what will happen is that every developer within its office network, within this private network, will have their own private IP addresses, which are different. You can have private IP addresses which are not registered publicly, and this can be used across different organizations for internal communication. Okay, but now suppose if these developers want to Google something, then they have to access the internet, and they have to access the internet via this router, which is also acting as a network address translator. So what will happen is these requests will go to this particular NAT device, and this particular NAT device will map these addresses with the publicly available IP address which is registered for this company startup XYZ. So it could be 125.10.12.13, and with this particular address, this particular request, regardless of whichever developer is asking for, will go and will contact the Google server and get the information back. And when the information will come back, this particular NAT device will pass it on to whichever private machine has requested it. So this is a basic understanding of NAT. So now we'll understand the different types of NAT we have, and also understand its working in more detail. So friends, there are basically three types of NATs: a static NAT, dynamic NAT, and NAT overloading, which is also called as port address translation, or PAT. So what is static NAT? Static NAT is very basic but never used, and this is like mapping one private IP address with a global address. But then this serves no purpose, because then you are not able to preserve anything using NAT. But this is called a static NAT, one-to-one mapping between one private and one public. So suppose if your company has only one computer, one person accessing the internet all the time, then maybe static NAT could be a thing, but it's useless. Dynamic NAT. Dynamic NAT is a technique wherein the NAT dynamically assigns the publicly available or publicly registered IP address to whichever request comes to the NAT device first. So suppose if you have developers in your company and they work in different shifts, so maybe your 50 developers come in the morning and try to log in at 9 a.m. So those 50 odd developers might get, or will get, the publicly registered IP addresses for doing their work. But what if someone from the other shift arrives early and they want to also, or he want to also, access the internet at the same time? Now all your 50 addresses are dynamically assigned to the first 50 requests which came in. But what about that 51st employee who has now come in and want to use the internet? So in those cases, although dynamic NAT is very effective, but in such cases, even this particular technique fails. Which brings us to the last or the third option, which is NAT overloading. Now in NAT overloading, we further utilize the publicly reserved IP addresses for our company based on the ports. So what the NAT device will do is, suppose this particular developer wants to access the internet, then it will assign a specific port using what we call as a PAT table. Okay, in that particular PAT table, this particular request will be mapped with a specific port. Now what it will help us in doing is that one particular publicly registered IP address can cater to multiple public addresses on multiple ports. So take for example, if this particular request comes in, the NAT device maps it with the same IP address 125.10.12.13, but on port suppose 123. For this particular IP address, it maps the same IP address, publicly registered IP address, but on port 567. And for this one, it does it for 8, 9, 10. So now what's happening, that for all these three, you are utilizing one particular IP address, and that can be done simultaneously on multiple ports. So this gives us even more flexibility for utilizing whichever publicly registered IP address we have, and cater to as many requests as possible. Friends, let's quickly refresh once again how NAT works with a little more detailed architecture. So in this, we see that there is an inside realm and an outside realm, and NAT sits in the middle. Okay, so suppose a machine with a private private IP address wants to communicate to the internet. So wants to communicate to the internet, then it will send the request to the NAT, and this is the NAT table. Okay, and this particular NAT table will convert this particular inside request to the outside request. Okay, so the data packet will traverse with the source IP at the starting, and while traversing towards the right, towards the destination, which is outside, it will eventually change into a publicly registered IP address. So this is the way NAT functions, and it is very straightforward, but then there are some limitations which we need to talk about as well. So the basic concept of internet is having end-to-end connectivity, but with NAT we are actually disrupting that very idea. So suppose there are protocols like TCP and UDP, those can be disrupted when we are using NAT. Okay, because like for example, UDP is a connectionless protocol. So if you are streaming something, for example, using UDP, then those kind of things can get disrupted with NAT. Another downside of NAT is that it could complicate VPN tunneling process, which is done through IPsec protocol. Because NAT changes the header information in the data packet, which is used by IPsec protocol for running integrity checks. So NAT could interfere with that. So there are these challenges which are posed, but yes, as we all know that NAT is a temporary solution to utilize and preserve our IPv4 addresses. But with IPv6 now being absorbed and adopted very quickly, there will be no requirement of NAT in future, because in IPv6 we have so many IP addresses, public IP addresses, that even every machine could have its own public IP address. So there will be no requirement of NATing. So yes, I hope this clarifies the concept of NAT to you. If you like this video, please let me know in the comment section. This was one of the requested topics, so I made a video on this. Also, let me know in the comment section what you would want to learn next in the field of IT industry, not only specific to networking, but in general. And I will be more than happy to do my research and bring up my perspective in front of you. So until next time, please subscribe to this channel. Please spread the word, share the knowledge, keep working hard, and yes, keep hustling. Bye for now.